Full-Time Gospel Hour, Program 545, Regular Version.
From the auditorium of the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, the faith partners and friends present Jerry Falwell and the Old Time Gospel Hour, celebrating over 25 years of Christian ministry.
Thank you. You may be seated. There's a snowstorm outside, believe it or not, and everybody here loves it. We also have a snowstorm inside. Dr. J. Harold Smith from Orlando, Florida. I won't tell you how old he is now, but his next birthday he'll be 73. And that's only a few weeks away. And this handsome, white-haired gentleman, Dr. J. Harold Smith, has had the privilege of preaching the gospel for over 50 years now, married to the same woman for 50 years now. And during his ministry as an evangelist and pastor, 1.25 million persons have come to know Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. What a delight to have him here. And I'm looking forward to his message today. Right now, Robbie Heiner's coming to sing for us. Robbie hasn't been married 50 years. One day he will be. I will still be his pastor. And just in the last year, great things happened in Robbie and Patty's lives, and that great thing is Buck. Is Buck going to sing for us today, Robbie?
No, sir. Yeah. In fact, you're going to hold him while I sing.
How old is he?
He's 6.5 months.
6.5 months. Now, that microphone enchants him, doesn't it?
He already plays the piano and everything.
Is he going to sing tenor or bass? Or?
I think he's going to be a bass.
A bass?
And he's going to be tall.
That's true. Like, may I hold him?
And the more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. Yes, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Since I started for the kingdom, and since my life he controls, and since I gave my life to Jesus, all the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Yes, the sweeter he grows, and the more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. Yes, the longer I serve him, the longer I serve him, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows.
Robbie, you know what he just told me? He said, my daddy is stronger than you are, preacher.
That's right.
Is that what you said? Here you go, Robbie. I'm proud of you, Robbie. You're a real man. Well, and when he's been married as long as you have, Dr. Smith, Buck will be 50, And Robbie, I will have preached his funeral years ago. Don't you think so? Possibly. Patty, congratulations. God bless you. We are in the midst of a recruitment time for faith partners because the Old Time Gospel Hour television radio program, television on 400 stations, radio on 500 stations, is supported by that select team of people. And, well, we have a goal to reach 150,000 new faith partners, and we still have quite a way to go. We need for people to pick up the telephone and dial us on our toll-free number. We have Liberty Baptist College students, in spite of the snow, who are right by the phones to take your call. It's a toll-free call. And to take the information, help you as you enlist as one of our faith partners. The number is 1-800-446-5000. I hope that today, during this program, if you believe that the gospel of Jesus Christ should be preached where you live, by television, on the station where you're receiving the program, that you'll call us and make your pledge, your monthly gift, whether it's $10 a month or more or whatever, and your regular prayers on our behalf will guarantee that this program continues. We have some wonderful materials we're sending out by UPS the moment we get your call, almost. This package right here, this Faith Partner package, as soon as you call in, a label is printed out, stuck right on that package. It's mailed to you. And inside it, as I will show you later, there is this Faith Partner study Bible that I preach from and that I think is one of the fine study Bibles that we have in the land today. In addition, two of the gold Jesus First lapel pens, your first copy of our newsletter for Faith Partners only. But more important than what we're sending you is what you're sending to others, the gospel of Christ by television and radio through your monthly gift. We need you on the team. We need for you to make the call. Please write the toll-free number down. If you live in Hawaii, Alaska, Canada, the number does not work. Write me, Jerry Falwell, Lynchburg, Virginia, or Box 505, Richmond Hill, Ontario. But whether calling or writing, I hope you'll do it now and become a faith partner of the Old Time Gospel Hour. Young people at Liberty are studying for a multiplicity of things. We have 42 majors, and this fall we're adding a pre-law major. We're adding computer science. We're adding home economics. We're moving out into many different areas. And God willing, one day we'll have schools of law, medicine, journalism, fully accredited. A university right now, a fully accredited school. But we are asking God to help us train up the young men and young women who can turn this nation around and make an impact for Christ around the world. Some of those young people are young people who are going to be missionaries. God's called them to another place, another land, beyond our borders. I think about 500, 600 of our young people have made public decisions to be missionaries for Christ. We have a family with us today, just returned from Brazil, Bud McCord. Family, and we thank God for Bud. He's been there 3.5 years since he left us here. The young people who are about to sing for you are called the Smite Singers, student, missionary, intern, training for evangelism, and God has called them at least to pray, if not to go, to a world that needs the Savior, the Smite Singers.
Christian. are joined together, all in one accord. We're putting on the armor in the service of the Lord.
Got the helmet of salvation,
gonna sharpen up my sword. We'll fight like we have never fought before. That's why we're ready for the battle, ready for the fight against the darkness. By living fully in His sight, ready for the battle, serving willingly. We stand upon His promise of victory.
Cause the battle's getting hot.
He's low on ammunition.
We've got him on the run.
And we can see the battle has been won.
That's why we're ready for the battle, ready for the fight against the darkness. By living fully in His sight, ready for the battle, serving willingly. We stand up.
Jesus did not die for just America or a particular segment of the world's population, but God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. We thank God for our Smite singers, for our young people and our student bodies who are called of God to take the saving gospel of Christ to the world. And that's what this television radio ministry is all about, taking the gospel to the world. And I want to say thank you to every faith partner who helps us do it. Our program is seen not only throughout the United States and Canada, but as well in Australia, the Philippine Islands, the islands of the sea, the Caribbean. And as a result of that, literally thousands of people come to know Jesus Christ every month who write us, who are born again as a result of hearing the gospel on the Old Time Gospel, our television radio ministry. And that's why we're asking God to give us additional faith partners to handle the spiraling inflationary cost. Men and women who will call our toll-free number and say, I want to be a faith partner. I'll give $10 a month. I'll give more. I'll be a part of your team, Jerry. And I hope that many of you will be led of God to help us keep projecting that gospel out to the world by the media. Right now, Mr. Mac Evans comes to sing.
And Jerry, that message is very plain in John 3:16. For God did so love this world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have this wonderful everlasting life.
Oh, how He loves you and me. Oh, how He loves you and me. He gave His life. What more could He give? Oh, how He loved me. Oh, how loves you. Oh, how He loves you and me.
The Word of God goes on to say that He came not into this world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. For He was not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. For in the while we were yet sinners, Christ on the cross died for us.
For he gave his life, what more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loved me. Oh, how he loves you. And me.
Dr. J. Harold Smith is called a pastor of pastors. I think this is a fair statement. If you would check with the evangelists and pastors of this land who truly preach the Word of God and ask them for a poll, for an opinion on who is the one preacher in America who has had the greatest impact upon you and your preaching. You know, I think of the last century, there's no question Charles Haddon Spurgeon was that man who impacted on preachers in helping them in their content, in preparation of messages, in delivery of the Word of God. Charles Haddon Spurgeon of England. Among those preachers who are living, there's no question J. Harold Smith is the consensus. He's the man whose sermons have been copied and preached by more other preachers than anyone else. I know yesterday he showed me a new packet of sermons that he's just outlined and printed out, and through the years, literally thousands of them. I've been to preaching conventions and heard J. Harold Smith's sermons preached by other preachers, and it's been done so much that everybody thought it, nobody knew it was Harold's, Dr. Smith's sermon. So I praise the Lord he can be with us for this week of meetings, this revival time, and for us right now. And I want you to give a warm Lynchburg welcome to Dr. J. Harold Smith. Dr. Smith, good to have you with us.
Dr. Falwell, it's really hard for me to say Dr. Falwell. I have been knowing Brother Jerry for 25 years coming here to this church. And I do not know in all of my ministry, and I do not know a preacher that I have more respect for and more love for than I have for your pastor. I believe that he's the most loved preacher in America and the most hated. Yesterday, when he and Brother Lowry came out to pick me up at the airport, I said, Jerry, you go out first, so if anybody shoots, it won't hit me. And Brother Jerry said, now, Brother Lowry, if you'll take his bags on over to your house, I want to take him around and show him over Liberty Mountain and Liberty College and the grounds. And it's been about 2 years since I've been here, and the growth just amazes me. And if I seem a little bit nervous this morning, it's not because of this crowd, but it's because I had to ride with him an hour yesterday. I've always believed that the Lord let me live till the rapture, but I sort of doubted it yesterday while I was riding with him. I thought for sure he's going to kill a dozen of you students. And then he'd come up to an intersection, and he'd beat on the car and jerk it and yell, and his wife and Brother Mr. Lowry, and I would just about jump out of that seat. I just finally got my handkerchief out and blindfolded myself so I could endure it. So I want somebody to give me a tour of the properties around here so that I can really enjoy it. Brother Jerry, I must say that I was simply amazed. I believe that Liberty Mountain ought to be changed from that name to Miracle Mountain. I came here 25 years ago for the first time when Brother Jerry had one little local TV station. It wasn't even colored, just black and white. And I remember what Brother Jerry told me. He said, Brother Harold, do you remember that? I said, yes, sir. I remember the time you were on at 5:30 on a Saturday afternoon. And I remember something your Brother Jerry told me the first telecast that I was ever with him on that telecast. He said, Brother Harold, he said, God's going to give me a worldwide ministry where I can preach the gospel to the ends of the earth by television. And I'm thankful that the Lord has allowed me to live to see that statement fulfilled. I don't guess Brother Jerry remembers it, but the Sunday I was here, they had a drive on to try to raise, that 25 years ago, $8,000. And they raised it in over. I don't listen to Brother Jerry very often on television because every time I do, he's got something new that's trying to get my money. And I hear the way he presents it, I just can't help but give it. I went into my secretary and treasurer of our organization, the Radio Bible Hour, and I said, I want you to send, and I named a sum of money that I want you to send in this drive, recent drive that you had. And my secretary said, we can't afford to give that much money. I said, yes, we can. I said, we can afford to go broke. But I said, Brother Jerry and his program cannot afford to go off the air. And that's the way I feel from the bottom of my heart. Brother Jerry, I love you with all of my heart, soul, mind, body, and strength. Referring to my age a moment ago, I'm determined to live as long as he lives. And I'll guarantee you that Brother Jerry Falwell doesn't get any more out of life than I get out. Many, many years ago, I made up my mind that I was going to live every day for the rest of my life. I know a lot of people, Brother, I tell you, 25 years old ought to be buried. They're dead. And I'm determined to live every day for the rest of my life. And I don't intend to really get ready if the Lord tarries until I'm 80. That means I got 7 more years to go before I get in high gear. Amen. I'm just going along here on an old propeller plane, but I'm going to get jet propelled when I get 80. If you look in the Bible, you'll find that Moses, for the first 40 years of his life, he spent it down there in Egypt learning all of the Egyptian ways. And then the next 40 years, he spent it trying to please his wife and his father-in-law in a desert. And then the last 40 years, he did what God wanted him to do. So I tell you, the last 40 years of my life, I want to really get busy for God and accomplish what God wants me to do. I know a lot of preachers today just waiting for the undertaker. Just waiting for the undertaker. Let's live. Young folk, let's live. There isn't a one of you young people here today, not a one of you that's going to live any longer than I'm going to live, because I'm going to live forever. I may change my residence, but I'm going to still be alive. Don't you ever say that J. Harold Smith is dead. I'm going to live forever. Have that thing that we call eternal life abiding in me. Amen. Brother Lowry, before I bring the message this morning, would you walk up here to the platform and lead us in prayer? This is Brother Charles Lowry, the fine attorney that represents this great church. And he told me last night, he said, I have an awful time keeping Jerry out of trouble. But Brother Jerry, when I was pastor, I had 26 lawyers. They were on my board of deacons of 60. And we had 26 lawyers, and they said it took all 26 of them to keep me out of jail. Amen. Maybe if Paul had an attorney like Brother Lowry, he wouldn't have had to spend so much time in jail. Brother Lowry, lead us in this moment in a prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you this morning. We pray, Heavenly Father, you be with Dr. Smith as he presents your word. We pray that each heart here be blessed. Should there be any here today that know not Christ as their personal Savior, we pray that your word will be so plain and true that they'll accept Christ this morning. Forgive us of our sins, for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
If you'd like to read the scripture this morning, I invite you to turn. Let us read together a portion of God's word found in Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, beginning with verse 4, where the word of God declares, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. And then you'll remember that over in the book of Romans, chapter 12 and verse 3, the word of God declares, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Now this morning, I want to speak to you on the theme of what do you think? I believe that if I could sit down and have an interview with every young person that is at Liberty College, I believe if you'd be honest with me and tell me what is on your mind and what is in your heart, I believe that I could tell you what you really are. Because the Bible declares, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is that man. And I'm just wondering this morning, really, what do you think? When I hear some man whose mind stays in the gutter, I do not have to ask that man, does he know the Lord Jesus? I believe that a man whose heart and whose mind is fixed upon the Lord, I believe that continually that man, his thoughts are wrapped around the things that are eternal and the things that are of God. My whole being, since the Lord redeemed me September the 4th, 1932, I had spent 8 years preparing to be a medical doctor. And when the Lord saved me about 6 days after I received my degree, after that, my sister led me to the Lord Jesus Christ. From the very moment, September the 4th, 1932, at 6:30 that Sunday afternoon, on the front porch of my sister's home in Greenville, South Carolina, my one thought and my one desire is, Lord, how may I please thee? And my one thought in my mind has been, what can I do, Lord? What can I do that'll bring glory to the name of my wonderful Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? I'd rather die. I mean it. I'd rather leave my wonderful wife a widow, and my daughter, and my son, and my only grandson and granddaughter. I'd rather leave them this day than to know that I would never be able to win another soul to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe with all of my heart that if our minds were fixed upon him, there would be a great compassion in our heart for lost souls. I have always believed that if the Lord Jesus Christ ever gets into your heart and gets a hold of you like he ought to get a hold of you, you'll think right toward other religions. You'll think right toward other races. And you'll think right toward your relatives. You'll think right toward every man and every woman on the face of this earth. And there will be a love and a compassion in your heart that you're not able to explain. As I look here in the Word of God, the Bible says, think on these things. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, it says, think soberly. It seems to me that in this mad age in which we're living, it seems to me that there is a shortage of sober, real sober thinking. If you look in the Bible, you'll find in the 50th chapter of the book of Genesis that Joseph said about his brethren, "Ye thought evil against me." In the 119th Psalm, you'll find that David said, "I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies." If you look in the 15th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, you'll find that a young man that thought his father's house was not good enough for him, and a young man that thought his father's diet actually was not sufficient for him, and he went to his father and said, "Give me that portion of goods that belongeth to me." And not many days thereafter, the Bible says, he took his journey into a far land or a far country. And there he wasted his substance in riotous living. And finally, this young Jewish lad found himself the keeper of hogs and under the employment and in the employment of hog herders. Certainly, I tell you, if we have a Jew here this morning, or one looking by television, you would have to say that no Jewish lad could ever fall lower than to become a hog feeder, hired out to hog herders. But this boy thought wrong. But there in that hog pen, he began to think about his father. He began to think about his father's house. He began to think about his father's table. He began to think about his father's servants. And he said, I will arise and go to my father. And I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Now, what do you think? Somebody has said that about 10% of the people think. About 10% of the people think they think. And the other 80% had rather die than think. And I imagine some of these professors around here could say amen to that to some of you students. But now, what do you think? First of all, every last one of us in this house, including the speaker, is more sinful and more wicked than you think. I'll guarantee you that every last one of you, when you get in the presence of a preacher, try to put on the dog. You try to act up. And you try to pretend that you're lots more holier than you are. I firmly believe that every last one of us are more sinful than we think. If somebody had met Cain that morning as he and his brother Abel were going out to build their altar and offer their sacrifice, if somebody had said to Cain, before this day is out, you will murder or you will kill your brother, he would have said, what is thy servant? A dog, that he should do such a thing? But he did it. He killed him. I believe that if Nathan, the great man of God that looked into the face of David and told him about his sin, I believe that if he'd met David that evening as David was climbing those steps to go up on the roof of his house to maybe pray or to think about the war that was being waged, and when he looked across the way and saw Bathsheba, Uriah's wife, I believe that if that faithful preacher had met him and said, David, if you go up those steps and you look over toward your neighbor's wife, you will commit adultery. And before this thing is over, you will have committed murder, and the sword of the Lord shall never depart from your house. I believe David would have said, why, what is thy servant? A dog, that he should do such a thing? But he did it. I've always believed that Judas, if Jesus Christ, or one of the disciples that had said to him 3 or 4 months before he betrayed our Lord, you will betray the Lord and sell him for 30 pieces of silver, he would have said, what is thy servant? A dog? They should do such a thing, but he did it. So this morning, if I get you to think about your own heart, not only you that are here in this audience, but all of you that are looking by television, if I could just get you as you sit right there to examine your heart and what you think in your heart, I believe that all of you would have to come up with the idea that you're more wicked than you think. I always enjoy going into a home to eat. Brother Lowry and Sister Lowry, I'm enjoying your home, your lovely, beautiful home. And recently I was invited into a home for a noon meal. And the pastor and I arrived about 15 minutes before the meal was prepared, and the husband met us at the door, greeted us. And I believe that they had the cutest little 4-year-old girl I've ever met in all of my life. I learned later that she had the IQ of an 8th grader, just 4 years old. And her mother said to her, to us, now, while we are finishing getting the finishing touches on the meal, little Anne will entertain you. And as soon as we sat on the settee, she came out with a deck of cards. And I said, Ann, where'd you get those? She said, right over behind the piano. She said, if you'll help me move that piano. I said, there's a lots of them over there. So I went over, you know me. I went over, brother, got a hold of the piano, pulled it out. Sure enough, there's 4 or 5 card tables, and there must have been 25 decks of cards back there. So I got me a deck. Little Ann already had her deck. I got the preacher a deck, but he wouldn't take them. And so we sat down on the settee, and we were spreading out the cards there on the settee. When her mother came in, she said, where did those cards come from? I said, right over behind the piano. I said, there's lots of them over there. If you want a deck, help yourself. I was in another home. And this home, brother, I tell you, was a wonderful home. The husband and wife, they were about 52 years old, and they'd never had any children. But they did have the cutest little dog I've ever seen in my life. I never will forget his name. His name was Fifi. When we got ready to eat, the dear lady said, you sit right over here on this side. My husband will sit here at the head. I'll sit here. And then, brother, she pulled up a 4-legged stool about that high and said, Fifi, Get on your stoop, right up on that stool. He went, sat right up on that stool, folded his little front paws together, and of course I bowed my head, expecting her to call on her husband or call on me to ask the blessing. And to my amazement, she said, "And Fifi will ask the blessing." Brother Jerry, that little old dog, he started. I tell you, he prayed as loud as a Pentecostal. And I said, "Lord, you've got to excuse me. I've got to open my eyes. I never have had a meal blessed by a dog. And Lord, I wanna see this." And so I just sat there and looked at that little dog. And I want to tell you, that's one of the best meals I have ever eaten in all of my life. And I tell you, ever since that time, I've been looking for me a French poodle. Yes, sir. Just to take him around and bless my meals. I want to say to you that all of this goes on in the homes when the preacher is there. I wonder what's in your heart. I wonder today if God's great X-ray could fold out here before us and that each one of us see what is in our heart. How many of us would not want it revealed what is in our heart? If I had a little camera and I could take your thoughts, just the thoughts you've had since you've been in this auditorium today, and it would be instant playback, how many of you would be willing, brother, to have those thoughts thrown here on the screen? Oh, I know you're so holy and good and sweet, but the Bible says that we're more wicked than we think. And then I tell you, we are more responsible to God than we think. The Bible declares that there is a responsibility to being a Christian. We are responsible to God for our T-I-M-E, our time. How do we spend our time? You know, I believe that one of the greatest efforts on the part of the devil on a Christian campus, is to steal the time of you students. Are you availing yourself of that wonderful opportunity and that wonderful time just 24 hours in a day? Brother Jerry, I just hate to go to bed at night. I feel like I'm going to miss something if I go to sleep. And it just seems to me like such a waste of time. That's the reason I'm glad that in heaven there's not going to be any night. Won't be any sleeping. Amen. We'll be awake forever. Time. How are we using our time? I know a lot of godly saints that spend about 4 hours a day, Monday through Friday, watching these godly soap operas. That's a waste of God's time and your time, and it's a disgrace. How would you like to die watching one of those soap operas? And have Brother Jerry say, "Aunt Becky, yesterday while she was enjoying As the World Turns, passed out." How would you like to meet the Lord, having the last thing that your eyes saw on this earth was some other man trying to take another man's wife? How would you like that? You're going to be responsible for your time. Then you're going to be responsible for your talent. I was sitting here on this platform a moment ago looking out at all these students and all this crowd, and with this snowstorm on here today, when I walked out with Brother Jerry there a moment ago and saw this church filled in the balcony and all over, I said, "Jerry, am I dreaming? Am I really awake yet? I don't believe, Jerry, this many people, brother, got through this snowstorm. Brother Lowry brought me over in a pickup truck." He said, "Do you mind riding in a pickup truck?" I said, "Just so Jerry isn't driving it." But I tell you, this snowstorm raging out there right at this very moment, and I couldn't help but think about all of the talent that's wrapped up here in this student body. Attorneys, preachers, evangelists, missionaries, lawyers, just what have you. And it's wrapped up right here. Brother Jerry gave me a tour yesterday down in all of the complicated departments of this great work here. And as I saw those young ladies there, and one year lady, brother, I tell you, he said, "Put J. Harold's name in there and see what he's given here to this work." I tell you, if you don't believe that bird will expose you, you got another thought coming. And brother, in just a second, brother, he said he had to go over to Boston And yet he didn't pick it up, and brother, before I could bat an eye, there was J. Harold Smith on that screen. I sure was glad I'd given something. I tell you, if you ever come here and you haven't given anything, don't let him take you on a tour. He'll take you by there. But the talent, God's going to hold you responsible for your talent. Don't bury that talent that God has given you. Then God's going to hold you responsible for your treasure. Oh, so many people today have robbed God. They're stealing God's money. I believe that every sinner, as well as the saint, owes God a tithe. Because a tithe is actually, brother, your rent that you pay on living on God's earth. And you know what happens to you if you don't pay your rent. If you're a renter, you know what the landlord does if you don't pay your rent. I know what you educated folks would say. You'd say you get evicted. Those of us are not. I say you get kicked out. And the reason that some of you have been kicked out is because you're behind with your rent. And then I tell you, I believe that our tithe is our utility bill. That we pay God for drinking his good water and breathing his good air. And you know what happens if you don't pay your utility bill? You get cut off. And some of us are cut off from the blessings of God. I believe I could get by with it just as well, or maybe easier, to go down tomorrow with a pistol and hold up one of the banks here and rob that teller and walk out of that bank. I tell you, with $1,000, I believe I could get by with it easier than I can get by robbing God. If you steal God's money. You know, I was asking Brother Jerry yesterday, and I don't guess, Brother Jerry, you mind me repeating this? I said, Jerry, how much have you invested here in Liberty Baptist College? Do you mind me telling him? He said, over $100 million. And I couldn't help but think, oh God, there's men out there today that could give $50 million, $100 million. They could leave it in their wills. They could do something with it now. They could put it here and just let this great college just pay them a reasonable interest. They couldn't even spend the money. And what has been accomplished? What could be done with another $100 million? But we rob God. What are you going to do with it? I tell you what you're going to do. Some of you men are going to die one of these days, and your wife's going to take it. And brother, she's going to marry somebody that's really decent. And they're going to come down to Florida, and they're going to have a big time down there in Orlando while you're kicking charcoals in hell. I tell you, I may die and my wife may marry again, but brother, I tell you, all that bird's going to get is another wife. And be a used one at that. I tell you, brother, you're not going to, when I die, brother, they're not going to be fighting over my estate. They're going to be scratching around trying to find enough money to bury me. Amen. But I say to you that God's going to hold you responsible for your time, for your talent, for your treasure. Then God's going to hold you responsible for the treatment. First of all, of the way you treat his Christ. Second, the way you treat his church. Third, the way you treat this clergyman, this pastor. The way you treat his child. And the way you treat the citizens of this earth, the lost sinners. God's going to hold us responsible for the way we treat them. I live in Orlando, Florida. I can't get used to this snow we're having up here. This is terrible. Boy, y'all come down to good old Disney. Man, the sun shines and we got it beautiful down there. I got tomatoes right in my garden at this very moment. And oranges and bananas and tangerines right in my yard. Man, I don't want none of this snow business. But I tell you what I'd rather do. I'd rather be shut up in the darkest dungeon on this earth and spend the rest of my life in that dungeon than to lift my hand against that man of God sitting back of me here today. I'll tell you, I'd rather take cyanide and believe I could get by with it easier than to lay my hand to hurt on this dear man of God. You better not touch God's anointed. Then I believe that we are closer to death than we think. The Bible says just one step between thee or between me and death. You know, a lot of you young people never think about dying. But if you could just realize it, There are more young people today committing suicide than any other group. There are more young people being killed in automobiles today than any other group. There are more young people dying from overdoses, I tell you, across this countryside than any other group. And life with you is just a breath away. If I could get every young person and every person in this audience and all of you that are looking by television to realize that just 3 feet back of you is death with his old iron claw-like hand reaching out to lay hold upon each one of us. And only the grace of God keeps him from touching us. And then every one of you that are lost are closer to hell than you think. You say, brother, it's hell. You say, it's hell. A sure enough hell, I sure do. You say, why do you believe it? Because the Bible teaches it. If there is no hell, there is no heaven. If there is no hell, there is no God. If there is no hell, the Lord Jesus Christ could not be my Savior, because the Lord said that there was a hell and that would make him a liar. And if he is a liar, he could not be my Redeemer. Hell is real. I used to teach and preach that if you ever go to hell, you'll never get out. But I was wrong. The Bible teaches that one of these days, just prior to the great white throne judgment, death and hell will give up the dead that are in them, and all of those that have died out of the Lord Jesus Christ will be brought up before the great white throne judgment, not to see if they've got a second chance, not to see if now after being in hell for all of these eons that they're ready to repent, but to receive the due reward of their evil deeds. And then the Bible says they will be cast into the lake of fire, where the smoke of their torment shall ascend up before the Father forever and ever. I believe that. And then, not only are we closer to death than we think, and not only, I tell you, are we closer to death than we closer to hell than we think if we're not redeemed, but then I tell you, every last one of us in this house is going to be longer in eternity than we think. The Bible says, man goeth to his long, long home. Brother Jerry, somebody has said that if a little bird could pick up a grain of sand and fly from the United States of America to England or to Europe and deposit that one grain of sand every 1,000 years, that when that little bird, making a round trip every 1,000 years, carrying as his burden and his load one grain of sand, when that little bird had moved all of North and South America to Europe, eternity would be in its first tick. So you're going to be longer in eternity than you think. And then last of all, every born-again believer in this house is richer than you think. You may not have much money in your bank account. You may not even have a bank account. Some of you students may be having it tough to see how you can meet this month's bills and how you're going to be able to stay in college. But if you know the Lord Jesus Christ, you're richer than you think. We are multimillionaires if we could only realize that we have life eternal, an eternal home, and a joy that is unspeakable and full of glory, and a peace that passeth understanding. There are some of you right here in this audience this morning. You belong to the church. Way back under somewhere, you joined a church. You were baptized just like I was. But I went all the way through the university not knowing the Lord Jesus. Miserable. I came to the place once when I picked up my father's gun and put it to my temple, ready to blow out my brain. But when I met Jesus, there came the sweetest peace that I've ever known and the greatest joy. And this morning, some of you that are in such a turmoil and you don't know which way to turn. Maybe you're out of a job. Maybe your family brother is in need and you don't know what to do. Look up. Look up to Jesus and ask him to help you. This morning, as we stand and sing this invitation number, I wonder how many of you will say, Preacher Smith, I'm more sinful than I really am willing to admit. I know it, I see it. I see that little sin, and I want you to pray for me. Would you raise your hand? Everybody in this house will say, "Preacher, I've got a little sin. I know it's there up in the balcony. I'm saved. I'm a born-again believer. But, preacher, I know I've got that little sin in my heart that needs to be confessed. Would you raise your hand?" Just put it up. Don't say a word. Just raise your hand. All right, as we stand to sing this invitation number, if you know that you're more wicked than you think, if you know that you haven't been carrying out your responsibilities to God, if you know that you're closer to death than you ever thought and that you're not saved, will you walk down this aisle? Let one of these personal workers help you as we stand. All right, let's stand as we sing this invitation number.
Just as
the message you have just heard, preached by one of God's great servants, Dr. J. Harold Smith, just may be God's opportunity for you to trust the Lord and be born again. I've been a Christian for over 31 years, and when I heard Dr. Smith bringing that message earlier today, I prayed that God might speak to many of you who are watching by television. You can't walk down the aisles as many did this morning here at Thomas Road. But right there by that television set, you can pray, "God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. Save me for Christ's sake." Won't you do that right now? And if you'd be kind enough to write me and tell me about it, Jerry Falwell, Lynchburg, Virginia, 24514. I'll send you a free copy of the same material we give those who walk the aisles here at Thomas Road. It's entitled, "How to Get Started Right." It will help you live the life you've received. And by the way, if you need counseling, need somebody to talk with you, pray with you, J.O. Grooms is our soul winning director. And if you'll give me your telephone number, just your area code and your telephone number, Pastor Grooms or one of our pastors will call you at our expense and counsel with you, pray with you, try to lead you to Christ. Did you know I've been on television now for 26 years? This ministry, Old Time Gospel Hour, 26 years. I was just a 22, 23-year-old youngster at the time when I started on television. I'm 49 now. Been on radio 26 years. And I know through these years, God has allowed us to lead hundreds of thousands of people to the saving knowledge of Christ. But I could never have delivered that message or have seen those results if it were not for my faith partners. Through these many years, faith partners have helped me do it. And I want you to become a faith partner. That's why the toll-free number is on the screen, 1-800-446-5000. Would you please dial me? I'm trying to enlist 150,000 faith partners. This is Palm Sunday. Next Sunday is Easter. Let's give a gift to our risen Christ by picking up that telephone, dialing me right now, and becoming a faith partner. I'll send you this package immediately. This is the Faith Partner Package. I'll ship it by UPS. You'll have it at your door in 3 to 5 days. What's inside this package? Well, I'll show you. First of all, there's a Bible inside that I preach from. I always give the page number. It's softbound. It's simulated leather. Here you'll see the Faith Partner insignia. Only Faith Partners have this Bible. And when you open the Bible, you'll find that it's the King James Version. Giant print, and every word that is difficult in a verse, well, it's explained at the end of that verse, and other scripture references to help you understand the Word of God. The words of our Lord are in red, as you can see. And in the back of this Bible, you'll find a concordance that will help you to find cross references and word definitions, etc. And as well as a concordance, you'll find the biblical list of maps that will help you to understand the geography of the Bible. And so, really, it is one of the finest study Bibles I know. It's small enough to take to church with you, and it's large enough to study at home. And I'll give you the page number every time I preach from the text. Only faith partners have this book, this Bible. Article number 2 in the package is a little jewelry box, just like this. When you open it, you'll find inside 2 24-karat gold-plated Jesus First lapel pins, one for you, one for another member of the family. Only faith partners wear that gold-plated Jesus First pin, So when I see you somewhere, or anyone sees you, they'll know you're a faith partner. Article number 3 you'll receive in the next several days at your door is a newsletter, a Bible study newsletter entitled, For Faith Partners Only. And there are Bible studies inside, on all 4 pages, information, questions and answers, ministry update, etc., etc., that you will get once a month in your home, and I think you'll be glad as a faith partner you get it. I'll write you a letter once a month, and we'll share some prayer requests with you, and I'll send you a prayer request form so you can mail prayer requests back to us. Our prayer warriors will pray for you by name, by need, and an envelope once a month in which you can send your $10 minimal monthly gift. Our faith partners, some give more than $10 a month, $15, $20, $25, but most of them give at least $10 a month, and that is what keeps this program on this station. I want you to call me on the toll-free number and become a faith partner right now. Join the team. Join the inner circle. I need your help, and your $10 or more monthly gift will help me keep preaching the saving gospel of Christ in your area and on hundreds of other television radio stations. Now listen carefully. If you call me before noon on Monday, I'm talking about Monday, March 28th, just hours from now. If you call me on the toll-free number before noon, March 28th, I'll send you a packet that we have been mailing out on the primetime program all of this month, the month of March. It's entitled Nuclear War and the Second Coming of Jesus Christ. Inside are 2 of my messages on cassette tapes entitled Nuclear War and the Second Coming of Jesus Christ. 2 tapes. And here is, in the pouch, a book that I've written entitled Nuclear War and the Second Coming of Jesus Christ. Now, those 2 cassettes and this book, if you call me before noon tomorrow, Monday, March 28th, becoming a faith partner, pledging $10 or more monthly to this ministry, I'll send you this along with the materials that I've just mentioned to you in the faith partner packet. That's my way of saying thank you, and it's also my way of getting you to call now. I need you as a faith partner on the team immediately. Please dial 1-800-446-5000. That number will not work if you live in Hawaii, Alaska, Canada. From those places, write me, Jerry Falwell, Lynchburg, Virginia, or in Canada, Box 505, Richmond Hill, Ontario. Thank you.
Thank you for watching this Old Time Gospel Hour program. If you would like to become a faith partner and help support this program in your area, then please call toll-free 1-800-446-5000. To show you our appreciation, we'll send you this beautiful giant print Faith Partner Study Bible. You'll also receive these 2 gold-plated Jesus First pins and, for faith partners only, a monthly newsletter which gives you a unique insider's perspective of this ministry. Finally, if you call before noon on Monday, March 28th, you will also receive this helpful prophecy packet. Included in the packet is Dr. Falwell's booklet, Nuclear War and the Second Coming of Christ, and 2 cassette tapes prepared by Dr. Falwell, which give you biblical answers to your questions concerning prophecy. So call today and become a faith partner. Again, that toll-free number is 1-800-446-5000. And now, a word from one of our sponsors.
Hello, I'm Walt Racine. This is my wife, Doris Racine. We're faith partners from Flint, Michigan.